Hey, 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 welcome to the CJ Silas Show. This is your spot every Wednesday night. CJ's been around the block, maybe even the world. She's got opinions, attitude. Some might even call her bias. She bleeds Dodger blue. CJ is a roller derby girl, a collegiate track athlete, and throws a mean curveball. She's been involved in sports her entire life. CJ's covered everything from the Super Bowl to the NBA Finals, the World Series, Tennis French Open, and the PGA Ryder Cup. And she's built lasting relationships in the world of sports. CJ will share her inside interviews and information with you each week. She uses humor and an open heart to inform and entertain you. Or at least she tries. She's still kind of waiting for her sports Emmy. Sports fans, here she is, CJ Silas.
Hey, 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 welcome in. Calm, live, and direct from the ESPN Radio 1280 AM and FM 101.7 studios of The Ticket in San Luis Obispo, California. If you notice, my voice is a little hoarse because I went to see my first live music since 2020. I think the last time I saw live music was maybe February, maybe March of 2020. I went out to an outdoor venue. I was kind of nervous about it. And I had dinner outside, and I went to the Poorhouse in Paso Robles. And so my voice is a little hoarse because I had fun, and I'm tired because I stayed up too late, and it's getting to me. I'm so pumped up. This is our last show before the 2020 Olympics begin in 2021, and it looks like it's actually going to happen. I was pessimistic, and obviously we know there definitely are some COVID numbers that are affecting the Olympics. And I think Griffin, my intern, who's just amazing with my COVID numbers, he gave me a couple from the Olympics. But maybe between now and the next few minutes, we'll check, because I think the COVID story in the Olympics will continue to change every day, actually hour by hour, similar to what happened in 2020 when there were a few sports that tried to come back, bubbled or not. Because always, the Olympic bubble is a bubble, but it's a pretty big one with over 90,000 people, I think, inside that bubble. Athletes, coaches, training staff, broadcast. I actually think broadcasting is not going to be inside the bubble. They'll be in their own bubble in Tokyo. The Olympics did already start. I'm just saying. Softball already started. Soccer already started. In fact, USA Softball, it's been 13 years. 13 years since we've had softball in the Olympics. The last time, ironically, the U.S. lost to Japan in the gold medal game in 2008 to get the silver. But last night, the women beat Italy 2-0. Kat Osterman, she came out of retirement, by the way. She's 38 years old. Proof that women can be badasses and they don't have to be youngins to matter and to care. She threw 6 innings, 1 hit, 9 strikeouts. It's amazing. And then Monica Abbott came in to strike out the side in the 7th. Remember, Osterman won the gold in 2004, and she was on that team that lost to Japan in 2008 to take the silver. No fans at the softball games. They're in Fukushima, and the IOC chose this site to honor the area after the nuclear disaster in 2011. I don't know if you remember that, with the earthquake and the tsunami. Japan beat Australia 8-1. And this is funny. It's not funny. It's ironic. IOC eliminated softball in 2005. It was some like top secret meeting and vote. So hypocritical. Exactly at the same time that when they were supposedly trying to narrow the gender gap in the Olympics. Well, softball is back. And Allie Carta from the Cal Poly softball coaching staff recently, she's on USA Softball. Mexico is also in. They lost to Canada 4-0. They're playing Japan tonight. So you've got 2 games tonight. USA and Canada at 5 o'clock Pacific. Mexico and Japan at 8 o'clock. And Sierra Highland, who pitched for the Cal Poly Mustangs and was also on the coaching staff, she is on the Mexican softball team. USA Soccer lost to Sweden. I just want to stop here for a minute. I don't like when the Olympics start before the Olympics start. The Olympics are supposed to start after the opening ceremonies, which are Friday, July 23rd. Today is July 21st. Yesterday was July 20th. Why are we having soccer and softball happen before the opening ceremonies? Just not cool. Who do I need to call? Ring, 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 Mr. and Mrs. IOC. Your scheduling is a problem. Your scheduling is making it difficult for those of us that want the Olympics to start with the opening ceremonies to get revved up, fired up, and pumped up for the Olympics when the opening ceremonies haven't even happened yet. Nobody cares what I think, but I'm just saying that's what I think. And I know I'm not the only one. We are going to talk more Olympics with the first base coach of the USA men's baseball team. Jerry Weinstein will be on the show in just a little bit. I do want to talk about the Blues real quick. They're 20-11. They're playing at home tonight against the Santa Barbara Foresters. And it is Black History Month, as we do all year. We really started making a shift in our strategy. That's not even the right word. The CJ Silas Show staff and crew made a shift in our desire, and we took a different turn on the road on our journey after George Floyd was murdered in May of 2020. We are lending our voice to brown and black people in and around the world of sports. And after February, the shortest month, which is the worst month to choose, after Black History Month, the celebration, we decided to continue moving forward with our Black History celebration throughout the whole year. And we did it as we honored black and brown people during Juneteenth. And we are going to do it until we don't want to do it anymore. And I think we're just going to keep doing it because it's about time that we honor and talk about people, not just athletes, as activists, sports people as activists, but others. And the way we're doing it is we're celebrating these people in the month that they were born most of the time, for the most part. I would say we're trying. This week, Mary McLeod Bethune, born July 10th, 1875, an American educator, stateswoman, philanthropist, humanitarian, womanist, and civil rights activist. She founded the National Council for Negro Women in 1935. She was appointed as a national advisor to President Franklin D. Roosevelt. She worked with him to create the Federal Council on Colored Affairs, also known as the Black Cabinet. She started a private school for African American students in Daytona Beach, Florida, and it later became Bethune-Cookman University, named after Mary McLeod Bethune. For her lifetime of activism, she was deemed and acknowledged as the first lady of Negro America by Ebony Magazine in July of 1949, known by the black press as the female Booker T. Washington. Mary McLeod Bethune. Randall Robinson, born on July 6, 1941, an African-American lawyer, author, and activist, founder of TransAfrica, known particularly for his impassioned opposition to apartheid and for his advocacy on behalf of Haitian immigrants and Haitian President Jean Bertrand Aristide. The TransAfrica Forum serves as a major research, educational, and organizing institution for the African American community. It offers constructive analysis concerning U.S. policy. It affects Africa and the African diaspora, African American and West Indians who can trace their heritage back to the dispersion of Africans that occurred as a result of the transatlantic slave trade in the Caribbean and Latin America. Randall Robinson. Arthur Ashe, born July 10th, 1943, won three Grand Slam singles titles. He was the first black man player selected to the United States Davis Cup team. The only black man ever to win the singles title at Wimbledon, the U.S. Open, and the Australian Open. Arthur Ashe is believed to have contracted HIV from a blood transfusion he received during a heart bypass surgery in 1983. He founded the Arthur Ashe Foundation for the Defeat of AIDS and the Arthur Ashe Institute for Urban Health before his death from AIDS-related pneumonia. He was just 49, and he died on February 6th, 1993. On June 20th, 1993, Ashe was awarded the Presidential Medal of Freedom by the United States President, Bill Clinton, after his death. Arthur Ashe was also an active civil rights supporter. He was a member of a delegation of 31 prominent African Americans who visited South Africa to observe political change in the country as it approached racial integration. Arthur Ashe, we will always remember him as a pioneer, an activist, and one of the best tennis players of all time, and someone in the black community in sports that made a difference on and off the court. Every week we honor brown and black people on the CJ Silas Show in and around sports as we continue to move forward and use our voice and use our platform on the CJ Silas Show not only to talk sports, not only to talk about athletes and coaches and ownership and competition, but also to recognize and be a part of the change and be the change and be active in our community to recognize, honor, and celebrate people of color that have helped to shift our world and our society. Though not enough, never enough, until all people are free. I do want to talk about history from last night, the all-woman baseball telecast with my girls, Alana Rizzo, Melanie Newman, Sarah Langs, Heidi Watney, and Lauren Gardner. Alana Rizzo, Heidi Watney, and Lauren Gardner all work for the MLB Network. Sarah Langs is an analyst and works for MLB.com. And Melanie Newman is a play-by-play voice for the Baltimore Orioles. The Rays beat the O's 9-3 in a historic game. Newman did the play-by-play. Langs was the analyst. Rizzo did the sideline reporting, and Watney and Gardner did the pregame and the postgame show. The first time ever it was an all-woman telecast on television for the American League game between the O's and the Rays. What does this mean for us? Women are finally getting credit. We can look back not that far to the hashtag MeToo movement. We can look back not that far to women standing up against Fox News. We can't look back as far as when I started in this business many, many years ago. People say to me all the time when they see me, friends, family, every time I watch women in sports on TV, CJ, I think of you. Every time a woman gets an award, CJ, in sports, I think of you. Were you forgotten? Did they pass over you? You're very good. You're very talented. Why didn't you get any of that, CJ? Why didn't you win an award? Why aren't you on national TV? Why aren't you on a national radio show 5 days a week on any radio sports network? And my mother said it best, and I'm okay with it. I'm at peace with it. I'm older than all of these women. They're getting their chances now. I have not stopped. I am lucky enough, fortunate enough, and have worked hard enough to have a radio show for 9.5 years that is called The CJ Silas Show. My podcast is heard in 21 countries. I've done national radio 3 times on ESPN, 1 time on FSR, on CBS, on Sports Fan Radio Network, on CBS Sportsline Radio Network. I have done it. I've been doing it for a long time. I just don't happen to be what you might think success is. And my mother said it right. I was ahead of my time. The women that are succeeding against sports TV and a few in sports radio now, in commentating, in play-by-play, as analysts, as podcast hosts, as television commentators, as studio hosts, as anchors, everything women are doing in sports is all in the past 10 years. And these women have worked just as hard as I did. They've gone to college for it. They've gone from the lowest level as they climbed the ladder to whatever level they want to be and then consider it their highest level. I'm okay with this. I love to see women succeed. Hashtag sports sisterhood. Hashtag breaking barriers. That's what we do. I have no complaints where I am in my life. I will complain if I die before I get a Major League Baseball stadium announcing job. But I think I will. I'm in line to get that. I'm in line to earn that Major League Baseball stadium announcing gig. And that will be probably my last job in this business, and I'd like to do it until I can't do it anymore. And I'm happy for Rizzo and Newman and Langs and Watney and Gardner and Taylor and women in this business, Kleinbart and Spain and Holmes. There are so many women. Mina Kimes, Malik Andrews kicked ass last night on that NBA Finals game. Am I the only one that thinks Malik Andrews kicked ass on that game and that whole series? It doesn't matter how she got there. If there's controversy surrounding what happened between Maria Taylor, well, really what happened with Rachel Nichols, it wasn't between anybody. It was something that happened behind the scenes at ESPN. How about Courtney Cronin? I'm so proud to call all of these women in this business my sister. I'm proud that they're all succeeding at any level. Beth Mowins, who I went to Syracuse with. There are just so many amazing and talented women in this business. I can't even name them all. How cool is that? Because when I started, there weren't any to name. There were a few. Robin Roberts, Andrea Kramer, Ann Montgomery, Kerry Ross, the fabulous sports babe. Linda Cohn started years ago when I started. But now, I can't name them all. And that is super cool. That makes me happy. I want to celebrate it. I want to honor the women that have worked hard with no jealousy, no envy, happiness, and joy for these women. Would I like to be on a national radio show 5 days a week? I used to think that's what I wanted to do. And of course, I would like to do it if I could still call it the CJ Silas Show and I could still do it my way. But I don't know if that's possible yet. There's not a lot of freedom for women in sports radio. Amy Lawrence at CBS, Sarah Spain at ESPN, they've got national shows 5 days a week and they're killing it. And they're talented and intelligent and provocative and entertaining and funny and clever and courageous. It took me 20-ish years to get the CJ Silas Show on the air. And now I have standards for myself that I don't want to succumb to somebody else's rules and do my show their way after all these years and after all the hard work and the struggles and the challenges and the research and the hours and hours and time spent on the microphone. Maybe Griffin, do this. Try to calculate for me how many hours of sports radio I've done in my life. Okay? So get your pen out because this is interesting. Get your pen out. Because when I got out of college and from Syracuse, and it doesn't matter when, I did TV for like 3 years. And then I decided radio, I did a little TV behind the scenes just to get my foot in the door. And then when O.J. Simpson killed Nicole Brown Simpson and Ron Goldman, and I will say that, I'm not going to even use the word allegedly, that's when I went into radio. So what year was the O.J. Simpson murder? 1995, I think. 1994, 95. It's okay. It doesn't have to be perfect. So then the O.J. Simpson trial verdict came in 1995. I think it was June-ish, right? About, right? October of 95, so starting in October, I started in Seattle a little earlier. I would say August of 95, I started doing radio 5 days a week. And I did that all the way through Seattle and Miami till 1999. So there's 4 years of 5 days a week. Then I came back to the West Coast because I just couldn't take the East Coast. I'm not lying to you. It's fun to visit, but I don't need to live there. Maybe. Have to be really, really, really big. And maybe a lot of figures. At least seven. So now we're in, what, 1999, and I haven't done any radio for a few years. I'm behind the scenes helping ESPN 2 start up. So then I get back on the air full-time in 2000. Let's go from 1999 to 2001. I did 2 days a week. I did weekends when I went back to Seattle. So for 2 years, 2 days a week. Are you following me, Griffin? We're doing the math here. Then when I got back on the air 5 days a week in 2001, I did that all the way through until now. So 20 years, no, 10 years ago, obviously, because now I'm on once a week. So from 2001 to 2012, when the CJ Silas show was born, so 11 years, right? 5 days a week. Then I went to 1 day a week for 9.5 years. Okay, so 1 day a week for 9.5 years. So, okay, so just guesstimate how many radio shows I've done. That's a lot of, that's success. That's a lot of radio. So are you doing the math? Are you got a calculator out? Griffin's looking at me like, you're really serious? You think I'm going to do these calculations for you? Okay, listen, Griff, it's 23 minutes after the hour. The show ends at 56. You have 33 minutes to do the math, okay? That's enough time, right? Okay, after Rafael Esparza from mybookie.ag comes on the show, at the end of the show, please, let's try to do that. Let's go back to this because it's interesting. Because people look at me and they have empathy for me and they feel sorry for me that I am not on the network at a national level or doing 5 days a week. But I like it this way because I get to do my show my way. There's no way that I could do Black History Month all year. There's no way I could have given my voice to black and brown people in this business starting the week after George Floyd was murdered. There's no way that I could have gone dark and not done a show and sat in silence last year if I was working for the network. Even though I'm not making huge money and I'm not on five nights a week, I have succeeded. And so you don't have to call me or text me or tell me you wish I could be la 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 la. Because I'm happy and fulfilled in my role right now because I've created this. And I've got this amazing set of interns. More women than men right now, my intern crew. That's pretty badass. When I first started, to get an intern, I was lucky, let alone a female interested in sports or a female that was curious or was allowed. So when you see a telecast like you did last night for the Orioles-Tampa Bay baseball game, celebrate it. Cheer for these women like I do. Alana Rizzo, Melanie Newman, Sarah Langs, Heidi Watney, Lauren Gardner are badass successful women in this business that I honor and I support and I celebrate. I don't feel jealousy or envy because these women are doing it and that's what we want. We want to break through the barriers so there are no more barriers. Whether it's women or people of color, the barriers are BS. Oh, I almost said it on the radio. Oh my gosh, I really caught myself before I said the word, and I was smart enough to say BS. I appreciate when you call me and you say, why aren't you there? Or you should be there. I am exactly where I should be, right here in the ESPN Radio 1280 and FM 101.7 studios of The Ticket, because it's my show. It's called The CJ Silas Show. I get to do it the way I want, and I get to do it with young people that are all in broadcasting and sports management school, and they're trying to learn. And I'm a partner with them in their journey. And if it all works out, they'll all continue on and call me to celebrate their new gig. And then I have succeeded. So it's not that I'm not grateful and thankful that you call me and tell me that I should be there and that you think that I've earned it, but I didn't try to be there. And those women are rocking it, and we all are, because girls talk sports. Coming up, Jerry Weinstein, first base coach for the U.S. men's national team, heading to the Olympics for the opening ceremonies this coming Friday. I do want to thank my partners for letting me do what I do and be crazy and go off like I just did. Dermatologist Dr. Brad Kurgis, dentist Daniel Lapidus, Michael Moore Sports Recovery, the Avila Bay Athletic Club and Spa, Joy, a juice and smoothie shop in Shell Beach. Rex Stevens at the Slow Wellness Center and California Fresh Markets, where I shop. Specials this week, Snake River Farms Meats from Idaho. Local Red Snapper and local halibut in the butcher department. And local strawberries two 16-ounce containers for $6. California Fresh Markets on Five Cities Drive in Pismo Beach, Foothill Boulevard in SLO, and El Rancho Market in San Ynez. Olympics coming up next on the CJ Silas Show on ESPN Radio 1280 AM and FM 101.7, The Ticket.
CJ Silas Show is back. Make sure your seats are in the upright and locked positions. Carry on luggage stowed and opinions intact. Here she is, CJ Silas.
Welcome back to the CJ Silas Show. You know I'm a honk for the Olympics, always talking about it. Happy that it's happening, bummed out that there aren't going to be fans, but glad for the athletes. And we like to go right to it. We like to get behind the scenes, talk to people that know what's going on. They've got the feel, the taste, and the touch of the Olympics. And who better to talk about Olympics and baseball than a good friend of the CJ Silas Show and a Cal Poly family member? He's the bench coach for Team USA, Jerry Weinstein. First of all, congratulations that you're going to another Olympics.
Thank you. Yeah, it's great. Lucky me.
Sheesh, you were at the Olympics in 92. You were at the Olympics in 96. You've been with the national team. You really, your career, are there moments when you think, did I get to do all this cool stuff?
Yeah, no kidding. I mean, every day I wake up, I'm with the college national team now, which is a great experience. I just look in the mirror and say, hey, it's pretty neat. And especially for an old guy, it's a really fun time.
Who called you? Did Socia call you directly? How did it go down? And I think, it was April you got the call that you were going to be part of the team. How did that happen?
A good friend of mine, Anthony Sanders, who was our outfield and base running coordinator with the Rockies, was the first base coach for the Olympic team for 2020. And then he got a big league job with the Orioles. He's the first base coach. And so we were talking. He said, are you interested? I said, yeah, absolutely. And so I had known all the people in the office. Paul Seiler was with USA Baseball for a long time, and I've had a long association with USA Baseball. And so Scott Brosius was the manager of the team, and I just joined that staff. And then Scott Brosius was unable to do it, and Soch got the job, and I know Soch well from our Dodger days and thereafter. So he just absorbed the staff and added Dave Wallace, a longtime Dodger pitching coach, and Mets and Orioles, really outstanding pitching guy, and he kept everyone else that was on the staff, previous staff.
He's Jerry Weinstein, UCLA grad. He is in the Olympics with the U.S. team. First time baseball's back in the Olympics since 2008. The 2020 Olympics begin this week in July of 2021, and we are lucky enough to have Coach Weinstein on the CJ Silas Show. I'm looking at the staff. Dave Wallace, the pitching coach. Rolly DeArmas, the bullpen coach. Darren Fenster at third base. Ernie Young. When you are standing around with these guys and Socia, and you're looking at them and you're thinking, my gosh, with the experience, is there any chance you guys don't win the gold? It seems pretty obvious to me with your team, the roster. How are you feeling about it going in?
Come on, CJ. How can you ask me that question? It's baseball. It's so unpredictable. Yeah, don't bet on baseball. And it's a short series. There's only six teams in the Olympics, and it's a trite saying, but it's absolutely true. On any given night, I think I experienced that firsthand with the Israelis in the World Baseball Championship, and we beat some of the better teams in the world. You know, and we were called the Jamaica bobsled team of the World Baseball Classic. And baseball is very unpredictable. You just don't know. And there are absolutely no guarantees. We expect to win the gold. We want to win the gold, but you've got to play the games. And there are a lot of traps out there. And baseball's very unpredictable some nights.
You mentioned Team Israel when you were, I remember it was at Dodger Stadium, and a kid from Cal Poly that you know very well, Joey Wagman, was on the team. And he is now one of the Olympians on Team Israel, and the U.S. starts against Team Israel. You know a lot about that team. How much is that going to help you against them in that first game in the Olympics?
Oh, I think everybody knows a lot about everybody. By the time you get to the Olympics, you've got a lot of scouting reports, and it gets down to execution. And, you know, no matter how much you know, you still have to make pitches, and you have to hit your pitch when it presents itself. So I think that nobody has an advantage over anybody else as far as scouting is concerned.
In 1992, he was an assistant at the Olympics. In 96, he was an assistant at the Olympics, was with the Dodgers. In 2000, at Cal Poly in the 2000s, Team USA Gold with the Maccabee Games, and now been with the Rockies organization almost 10 years. Coach Jerry Weinstein on the CJ Silas Show. Let's talk about that roster with the MLB experience on the team. It's a 24-man roster. You're going in. Joey Wagman said to me recently that it's different than Major League Baseball schedule because you don't have the 162 games. It's groups and then it's elimination. It's real quick. So how do you set a pitching staff for a series like this as opposed to Major League Baseball?
It's not a whole lot different, but you're going to have fewer long stints. It's going to be more, there'll be more bullpen games, especially for certain teams. I think that's one of the things that we did in the World Baseball Classic. We just kept giving teams different looks. I think probably we have more quality depth relative to our pitching staff. Probably can get more innings out of our starters than many, even though I would think that would be the case for Korea and Japan as well. Who knows? But we do have 12 pitchers, and we feel like that's the strength of our pitching staff. And we have veterans in David Robertson, who closed for the Yankees for a number of years. And we have Edwin Jackson and a number of other guys and some young power arms as well, Anthony Gose and Joey Ryan, and a lot of different options as far as the pitching is concerned.
He's the bench coach for Team USA going to the 2020 Olympics here in July 2021. Jerry Weinstein on the CJ Silas Show. What exactly does a bench coach do?
When Mike Socia is the manager, he does very little. As a matter of fact, I'm actually coaching first base. Mike doesn't need a bench coach to help him run a ball game. He's as good as anybody. And so my role, more or less, is I'm coaching first, and we talk in the dugout, especially when we're on defense, and in terms of positioning and the scouting reports and those types of things. But it might be the title, but more than anything, I'm coaching first base, and then providing a little input during the time that we're on defense.
What do you think about the Olympics with no fans? It's going to be kind of odd, right?
Oh, any game with no fans is going to be odd. The last Olympics I was at, I was the pitching coach for Skip Bertman on the 96 team. And I do remember we played at Fulton County Stadium, and there were over 60,000 people in the stands, and 59-9 had flags and were shouting USA. It was pretty empowering. This will be a lot different.
Jerry Weinstein on the CJ Silas Show, traveling to Tokyo with the men's baseball team. Super exciting. I did want to ask you, because you are full-time when you're not out in the world working for the Colorado Rockies organization. You do come to some of the Cal Poly games. And I just wanted to get your thoughts and your take on shortstop Brooks Lee, Larry's son, who's just getting so many accolades in the postseason. He could have been drafted when he came right out of high school, chose to go to Poly and play for his dad. How good is this kid?
He's on our college national team tour, so I see Brooks every day. We have two teams. We're playing inter-squad games because of the COVID. We were not able to play international teams. But I see Brooks every day, and he's on the other team. And he's been unbelievable. He's a gamer. He really understands how to play, and he's got a really, really diverse skill set. He can do everything. He's very, very, very good player, and I think the people at Cal Poly know that. Of course, his dad knows him better than anybody. But as fans, you know, he's a guy you want to go out and see. He's going to be a top draft pick next year, and he's done nothing to diminish his stock. On this tour, he's swung the bat extremely well. He's played both shortstop and third base, and has played well defensively and swung the bat outstandingly.
You've been to the Olympics before. This one's going to be different like no other. We will never see this kind of Olympics again with no fans during a pandemic. How are the protocols so far that you've heard of on what you're going to have to go through in Japan, getting to Japan, and while you're there?
Well, in the qualifier, we were in what was called a bubble, I guess kind of like the NBA bubble, and I suspect the Olympic Village is a bubble in itself. Our staff is staying in a hotel in downtown, the baseball staff and a lot of the administrators. We won't be in the village, but we'll be able to go to the village. But there's, you know, a lot of testing, a lot of mask wearing, and a lot of a lot of rules for contact outside of the baseball group. We won't be seeing, we won't be running around seeing any games. In reality, we didn't do. I've been to two Olympics, and I've yet to see an Olympic event because we're either practicing or scouting or playing, and so that won't be different for me in that sense. But I think it'll. I think the protocols will be very tight. We tested a lot in Port St. Lucie when we were down there in West Palm for the qualifier, and I think the same will be here before we go. And there won't be a lot of sightseeing being done. Let me put it that way.
He's probably one of the best baseball minds I've ever met in my entire life. He won the Baseball America Tony Gwynn Lifetime Achievement Award. He was at UCLA, Dodgers, Cal Poly, now with the Rockies for years, but right now prepping to head to Tokyo as the first base and bench coach for Team USA, Jerry Weinstein, on the CJ Silas Show. Before I let you go, I just want to thank you publicly for your support, encouragement, cheering, and everything that you did for me those 6 weeks in the spring when I was up for that job with the Chicago Cubs. I have to tell you, and I haven't seen you since, and I really would have loved to seen you. The experience was not just epic because I got so close to getting a Major League Baseball job, but what was even more incredible to me, Jerry, and you were part of this, was who showed up for me. Who stayed in touch with me the entire time, checked in, cheered, made a phone call. And I just want you to know I've known you since you were at Cal Poly in 2001. That's when I started as well. And I just want you to know that meant so much to me to have you in my corner.
Well, I appreciate that, but you know I'm a big fan, and I'll be there for you whenever you need it.
We're going to have such a big party when I get a Major League Baseball job. I just have to make sure that it happens when no one's out of town, when everyone that lives in this area that's in baseball. So I want to find out, like, Memorial Day, you know, right when Cal Poly's heading to a regional or right when the season ends, so that we can have a really big party, because I feel like it's close, and I appreciate, I know you made a few phone calls. I don't know who got somebody got my resume in front of the right people, because it easily could have been lost in spam or whatever. And so I'm trying to thank everyone, because it was such a cool experience having you there. And I know you were with me, and your wife was cheering for me as well. So thank you for that. Good luck. Be safe and enjoy this odd but incredible moment in your life when you get to go to a pandemic Olympics in 2021.
I'm planning to do all of the above. Thanks.
Jerry Weinstein, you will be able to see him at all of the U.S. baseball games during the Olympics, the first time since 2008. Coming up next, the Cal Poly Sports Update on ESPN Radio 1280 AM and FM 101.7, The Ticket.
We're back with the CJ Silas Show on ESPN Radio 1280. Here's CJ.
Welcome back to the CJ Silas Show. I wish that me and Rafael Esparza lived in the same town, because I think we would have fun. His wife would like me. She'd probably let me come over and cook dinner for me, because we're fun and he's the best. He's head odds maker at mybookie.ag, a regular on the CJ Silas Show program, joining us now. Hello, friend.
Hello, how are you, CJ?
I'm doing well. What do you think about me inviting myself over to your house for dinner?
Anytime my door is open on both my homes, when you're in Vegas, you're more than welcome to come over. And if I'm in New Orleans, you're more than welcome to come to my home in New Orleans as well.
I think I would pick New Orleans now that I know you have the second home there.
Well, for food-wise, for dinner-wise, yes, I would pick New Orleans over Vegas in a million times when it comes to food and eating.
What are the odds that I actually get an invitation to come over to your house for dinner? Do you have any prop bets on that?
So I will work on those right now, just because that would be cool. I think we would do a lot of damage in both cities if that was the case.
I was hoping there would be a game 7 in the NBA Finals so I could have you talk about that. But Giannis and the Bucks finished it off last night in game 6. They are the world champions. So instead, we're going to talk a little bit Olympics and some Major League Baseball, looking at the second half of the season. Let's start with the Olympics. The softball and soccer has already started in Tokyo. Gymnastics and swimming, basketball, that'll all happen coming up after the opening ceremonies on Friday. What are some of the more interesting Olympic bets you have right now that are popular and making some money?
I think a lot of people are betting. You can bet total over-under goals for each country. A lot of people getting action on that. You can also bet total medals for each country, but we just came off the NBA Finals. I mean, and we have three guys that are getting ready to jump on a plane to join USA in the men's Olympics, and they play on Sunday at 7 a.m. Central, so was it 4 o'clock Pacific time against France, which we already have a betting number up. USA's minus 11.5, total is 178. So how those three guys, Booker and them, going to be, are they going to be able to play right away? Because you figure they have a lot of miles on those legs. I hope they can sleep on a plane. But it's going to be very interesting to see how those three guys help out the men's and the women's. Because let's face it, both of them have struggled in their exhibition games. USA women, they open up on Monday, I think at 11:30 Eastern Standard Time against Nigeria. But let's say USA, they're minus 31 against Nigeria. The total is 154. So minus 31, I would take the money line on USA. I think they easily.
On the women. On
Nigeria.
Okay, and then what about the men opening up against France on Sunday?
You know, it's a number opened up at 14.5, and it quickly got bet down to 11.5. So France is no pushover. I think this number continues to go downward just because I think people realize that the USA is very fragile. I don't know if they're going to have those three guys playing in that game. I'll probably have to take the plus points, but if it goes down less than 10, I'll probably jump on USA.
He is Rafael Esparza, head odds maker at mybookie.ag. Best payouts, a lot of great sign up bonuses that you get because when you're a first timer, they give you a lot of incentive to stick around. Biggest payouts and a lot of fun, different stuff as well. He's joining the CJ Silas show. Gymnastics, swimming, track and field. Do you have any bets for those in the Olympics?
Yeah, we have a whole bunch of each events out for gymnastics. We get a lot of action on artistic gymnastics, the horse for men's, Max Whitlock is the favorite, and that one getting a lot of action. We'll put the women's odds up probably in the next couple of days. We put the men's out first because let's face it, the women will probably get three times the action as the men's. Just like in soccer, we take three times the action on women's soccer when USA plays than we do on any of the men's teams. So we'll put up women's gymnastics up tomorrow. But badminton get tons of play too. Yes, you can bet badminton at the Olympics. Quinto Modo is a huge favorite. Can't wait to see him.
Wait a minute. Badminton gets big money?
Oh, yeah. Badminton gets good. Table tennis gets huge money. Of course, swimming does. Diving gets a lot of action. It just amazes me. But there's some events that I love. I love all the track and fields. But give me some beach volleyball.
What about Simone Biles? Do you have any prop bets around her?
I knew you were going to do that. So like I said, we, before I even post a number, we'll probably get bombarded of action on gold. But she's going to be the heavy favorite on all her events. We'll probably have to put it at least minus $5 or higher on all the events because I just don't see anyone beating her unless she gets an injury. Hopefully she does it because I just love watching her perform. She is G-O-A-T when she steps on the mat.
That's true. Rafael Esparza from mybookie.ag, head odds maker and a friend of the CJ Silas show. MLB season MVP and the two World Series teams.
For National League for MVP, I don't know why Jacob deGrom is still getting a lot of action. He's always hurt. He's a pitcher, but give me Fernando Tatis. I think if they can win or make the playoffs, I think they give it to him. You can get plus 120 money on him. Give me Fernando Tatis. Maybe Trey Turner and Nick Castellanos from Cincinnati, but I just like Tatis because I think San Diego is going to make it far in the playoffs. For the NL, it's your boy in your backyard. Come on, it's Shohei. It's Ohtani. He's a heavy, heavy favorite. But keep an eye out for the guy that stole the All-Star game, not the Home Run Derby. Vlad Guerrero Jr., he's plus 220. I think if the Blue Jays can make the playoffs, I'm sorry, I don't think the Angels make the playoffs. Vlad Guerrero Jr., I think, is a nice ticket to have. And my World Series, I'm going to have to say someone in the NL West. I don't know who it is. It could be San Diego or Dodgers.
Okay.
I think one of them make it to the World Series. And I think it's going to be either Tampa Bay. I like them to go back into the World Series as well.
All right, Rolf, you're the best. Have a great night, and we will talk again in August. Hopefully, we'll get some NFL odds going in August.
Got some big NFL prop bets coming your way through your email.
That was Rolf. What happened? Rolf? Oh, my goodness. Hello, Rolf. Oh, gee, we lost it. Well, at least we got all the good stuff in. Rafael Esparza from mybookie.ag. I guess we're going to start talking some NFL next month. This segment of the CJ Silas Show is brought to you by dentist Dr. Daniel Lapidus. highly trained in cosmetic dentistry. They have all the latest technologies, individually focused practices, and they're COVID safe. Trust me, in a new building. Give them a call. They're taking new patients, 805-543-7993. The Cal Poly Sports Update. Cal Poly Beach Volleyball earned the USMC AVCA Team Academic Award. They held a GPA as a team for the entire year, 3.3 or above. Seven players were on the all-academic team as well. This is the first time that Cal Poly Beach Volleyball has earned this team award. Allen Hancock College announced its football schedule. Five home games opening up on September 4th, hosting Santa Barbara. Five road games, and the season begins. That's Labor Day weekend. They do start practice any minute. I'll be at Hancock College next week. It feels like it's early, but I'm so happy to have football back. They have a scrimmage of blue and gold on Saturday, August 21st. I don't think fans are allowed yet. I will keep you posted on that. And then they're playing in a tri-squad scrimmage at El Camino with Claremont as well on August 26th. You can watch all of those games, starting with the home game, the opener, on September 4th at athletics.hancockcollege.edu. Baseball at Hancock schedule came out as well. They open their season on the 21st of January. That seems early as well at Cypress, and their home opener is January 27th. That is a look at Allen Hancock College and Cal Poly, your sports update. The contest, Griffin, the contest. The question is, we're doing this contest all month long. So next week, are we giving away our first Lakers championship poster? That's next week. This is how you get your name in the hat, and then next week we'll pull one out live. I think we have, like, what, 50 names in the hopper about? Wow, nice. You get a Lakers championship poster from last year, which will be historic because it'll be the only pandemic-shortened season. So it'll be it'll actually probably be a collector's item at some point. All you do is you go to my Instagram, The CJ Silas Show, follow along with the contest rules. The question tonight is, what is a sports memory that you have, CJ, that you will never forget even if you tried? And I'll tell you what it was. Do I have time? Did I do everything? Oh, I didn't do the COVID numbers. Let's do this. This may be more important. Max Muncy, in a World Series game against the Boston Red Sox in 2018, a game, by the way, in which I couldn't find anyone to go with me. I went by myself. I spent $750 on the ticket. I spent $250 on parking because I had to go to a game. This Friday night game was the only night that would fit into my life because it was in the middle of Hancock College football. I drove down for the game. I got to the stadium when the gates opened at 3:30. I hung out. I sat in the right above home plate. And I was there, and I had a dog sitting job, and I had to ask a neighbor to check in on the dog because I was probably going to be home. If the game started at 5:30, I'd probably be home. Game would be over at 8:30. I get home by 11:30. So I left at noon. So they took the dog at like 4, took it back home at like 10, and it would have been okay. However, the game went to 18 innings. I had to call the dog neighbor friend at like 11:30 and wake him up and say, hey, I'm still at the stadium. The game hasn't ended yet. Max Muncy led off with a home run in the bottom of the 18th inning as the Los Angeles Dodgers beat the Red Sox in that game. I hate to say it. The Dodgers, I think that was the only game they won in that series. I'm pretty sure the Red Sox won that series 4-1. My memory is not as good as it should be, but I'm pretty sure that they won that series 4-1, and I was at the only game. I paid $1,000, but I paid for 2 games because it was an 18-inning game. See? That's my story. And now all you have to do is go to Instagram and follow us, like the story, tag a friend, put your name up there, and your name will go in the hopper. Oh my gosh. It's our first month of this big contest that Griffin and Gabriel have put together. We have some amazing things. Kobe Bryant signed posters. I've got a World Series bobblehead from last year, Corey Seager. I've got a Cody Bellinger bobblehead. I've got a lot of stuff. I'm giving away stuff from my personal collection, by the way. Next week, we're back. Same bat time, same bat channel. 5 o'clock Pacific, 8 o'clock Eastern. I'm going to turn off my mic now, and I'm out.
We'd like to thank our loyal partners, Avila Bay Athletic Club and Spa, Dr. Brad Kurgis Dermatology, Costa de Oro Winery, dentist Dr. Daniel Lapidus and Larry Ackerman, Rex Stevens at the Slow Wellness Center, California Fresh Markets, Michael Moore Sports Recovery, and Joy, a juice and smoothie shop in Shell Beach. Make an appointment to listen every Wednesday, 5 p.m. Pacific on ESPN Radio 1280 AM and FM 101.7. Listen to the podcast wherever you find yours or on CJ's website at thecjsilasshow.com. CJ's turning off her mic now, and she is out.